Terzijde van de A16, de Rijksweg Rotterdam-Dordrecht, is bij Ridderkerk onder de naam Renovalt een installatie neergezet waarmee oud asfalt voor hergebruik geschikt kan worden gemaakt. Het is een gezamenlijk project van 5 wegenbouwmaatschappijen. De A16, berucht om zijn files, zal ter hoogte van Ridderkerk geheel worden gereconstrueerd. Met de uitvoering van dit werk, dat naar schatting 3 jaar zal duren, heeft Rijkswaterstaat de aanzet gegeven tot het hergebruik van oud asfalt op grote schaal. Ter beperking van onnodig lange transporten is de asfaltrecyclinginstallatie in de directe nabijheid van het werkterrein opgesteld. Om het proces continu te laten verlopen, wordt een buffervoorraad van het oude asfalt aangehouden. Het materiaal wordt allereerst gestort in een 5-tal stoomcompartimenten waarin het asfalt wordt opgewarmd tot 85 graden. Onder invloed van de stoom ontstaat een temperatuursverhoging en dringt er vocht in het asfalt binnen, waardoor het uiteenvalt. Het materiaal wordt vervolgens gezeefd, waarbij alles wat geen asfalt is, wordt afgescheiden. Wat overblijft gaat dan naar een door Renovalt speciaal ontwikkelde droogverwarmingstrommel, waarin het tot maximaal 175 graden wordt verwarmd, zonder dat het verbrandt. Het hele proces wordt met behulp van een computer bestuurd. Het asfalt in de droogtrommel moet nu zijn oorspronkelijke veerkracht terugkrijgen. Dat gebeurt door het in een volgende fase te vermengen met een zogenaamde verjongingsolie. Het nu geregenereerde asfalt is belangrijk goedkoper dan het asfalt uit nieuwe grondstoffen. Basis daarvoor zijn immers de aardolie, die bijna elke week duurder wordt, en zand en grind, waarvan de voorraden in onze bodem beperkt zijn. Het asfalt onderscheidt zich bij de verwerking op de weg niet van het nieuwe. En de tweede levensduur zal naar verwachting niet afwijken van die van de eerste. Van de weg bij Ridderkerk, die straks niet alleen een van de drukste, maar zeker ook een van de modernste van ons land zal zijn, komt elke werkdag een nieuw stuk gereed op basis van gerenoveerd asfalt. De installatie die dit levert, is deze dagen door minister Tuinman officieel in gebruik gesteld. Het bedrijf, een voorbeeld van goede technische samenwerking, is het enige in de wereld dat oud asfalt voor 100% regenereert. Een procedé dat zeker ook toepassing zal vinden bij andere wegenbouwprojecten, zowel in Nederland als in het buitenland.
Het had weinig gescheeld of de vodderrapers van Parijs, zo nauw met het stadsbeeld verbonden, waren verdwenen. Uit hygiënische overwegingen en om het uiterlijk van de stad te verfraaien, had het gemeentebestuur haar namelijk verboden voortaan nog de vuilnisemmers te doorzoeken. De 40.000 vodderrapers die in dit werk een broodwinning vonden, hebben hier tegen een protestactie op touw gezet en het resultaat was dat de maatregel weer werd ingetrokken. Oud papier en lompen, met tonnen tegelijk wordt het ingezameld. Vervolgens wordt het afgeleverd in de voddenpakhuizen, waar talrijke mensen werk vinden bij het sorteren ervan. Alles wordt in balen geperst om daarna vervoerd te worden naar de verschillende fabrieken die het opnieuw verwerken. Dankzij het werk van deze mensen blijven enorme hoeveelheden grondstof voor de Franse economie behouden. En men heeft dit gelukkig bij tijds ingezien. De Parijse voddenrapers zullen niet verdwijnen.
Welcome everybody for the final session of this day about circular economy as part of the CLIQ NL Design Drive 2015. We have prepared an hour program with many things. You see a couple of people who will turn up on stage, but there are even more than those. And as you could see from the film, the clip in the beginning, the concept of circular economy is not that new as we maybe think it is. And of course, we're also circulating old audiovisual material from Beeld en Geluid, as you could see also. Today we have actually 3 main components of the program in this hour. First, we have the concept of products that last, which is also a title of a publication you might have seen already. We have a couple of people speaking and a couple of events coming up. Even We have the result of a competition of students. We have a speaker, and we have also a book. Then we will talk about a transition. We talk a lot about transition economy, but we'll also have a transition here, which concerns a project which is actually finishing off this year and which will be transformed and transferred to a new situation. And of course, Click & L Design is playing a key role in that. And then at the end, we will look at the results of today in a very sketchy fashion, because we are not able to summarize all the findings and the results of this day in 15 minutes. But we will have a glimpse of what came out today. Without further ado, I would like to introduce to you a speaker, which is also an author of one of the books which is going around and which will be presented later on. Marcel den Hollander, who will have a short introduction of about 10 minutes on the topic of the circular economy. Marcel, the floor is yours.
Thank you. Hi, welcome. For this session, I was asked to tell you a bit about the state of research with regard to the circular economy. And people saw me fit to do that because Connie Bakker and I worked for over 3 years in a research project called Products at Last on product design for circular economy. What we found in our research was basically that there are three major questions that need to be answered. And that is, where are we today? What is our future goal? And the last one, how do we get from A to B? And with regards to A, there's a lot of research going on different universities and in different countries. For example, the work by Thomas Goodell, an industrial ecologist, who's actually, with his PhDs, is trying to make a map or an inventorization of what elements there are, what elements are critical, and whether or not we will be able to replace the one with the other. We have people at our university in Delft working on the same topic. On the second topic, what is our future goal? We know it's also very important not to just blindly head in a direction, but ask ourselves very critically whether life extension of products is actually where we need to go, in what cases we need to go in that direction, and in what cases we should avoid that. Future goal also has to do with what type of business models do we want to use in the future. We now have a sell more, sell faster model that actually really drives our throwaway society. But are there other alternatives available to us? And a lot of work is being done also in that field, also at the TU Delft, but also elsewhere, for example, the work by Nancy Bocken, one of my colleagues. And the last one, how do we get from A to B? Actually is also what we think a very important and useful one, especially to designers. And how do we get from A to B mainly is what our work in Products at Last was concerned with. So I would like to tell you a bit more about what we did in that specific piece of research. What we tried to do is create a map or a framework where we link together business with industrial design, and trying to give people an indication, give designers an indication, give business professionals an indication where things could go and might go in a circular economy. We did that by identifying five business model archetypes, we call them, because there are as many business models as there are businesses, but this is on an abstract level, where we actually are able to extract business value from and over the longer lifetime of a product. You will all get a copy of the book, so you can read through this at your leisure. But basically, it's important to realize that there are ways you can use as a business to actually make money from products that have a longer lifetime and that are used for a longer time. And these range from the way that Miele chooses with longer-lasting washing machines and selling them once, to at the bottom end of the scale, paying for result. For example, what Philips uses with Paperlux, where the customer or the end user does not pay for fixtures or energy or whatever, but only pays for light, for the end result. That's for the business side of things. The other side is design strategies. What can you do as an industrial designer? Well, we distilled six strategies that you can employ as an industrial designer. And they range from one of the most effective, but at the same time, one of the most difficult ones to design for, which is that of attachment and trust. How can you design and develop a product that is actually liked, loved, and used by people for a very, very long time? And it's very hard to predict whether or not you will be successful. It's very hard to design for, but once you succeed, you actually create a product that will last for a very long time. The next ones down the line are, in a way, more or less self-evident. The next one is durability. If you want a product to last long, make sure it can actually last a long time. And then it goes down to standardization, design a product in such a way that the parts used can actually fit other products, so you can repair it and keep it operational for a long time. Ease of maintenance, one of the easiest ones. If you take proper care of your product, it is likely that will serve you for a long time. Upgradability and adaptability. If you maybe your product still works, but your needs as a user have changed, what can you do to make sure that you don't throw away your product, but actually are able to adapt it to your new needs so you can keep it? And the last one, dis and reassembly. We've seen that combine a number of other sessions today, where even if you have a product with a long lifetime, in the end, it will need to be disassembled. Maybe some parts can be used, other parts will be reused in their material form. And for that, it's very important that you can actually take them apart. And in some cases, you can actually use old parts, combine them with new ones, and create new products out of those. What we also did in that framework is try to make the connection between the two and say something about when to use what. And it turns out that what design strategy actually fits, what type of product can be shown with what we call product lifecycle category curve. You have products that are really new to the market, really innovative, and change quite quickly. And in that case, it doesn't make much sense to develop a product that can actually physically last 30 years, because after 2 years it will be outdated in its functionality. On the other hand, if you have, again, a washing machine, the technology doesn't change that quickly, so there it might make sense to make a product that actually can last a longer time. And that's shown in this curve. What I want to share with you in conclusion is basically what we've learned from our research. With regard to new research, is that you've all heard of the law of Lansing, probably, which is reduce, reuse, recycle. That also applies to research in a way. And what is shown here is what we call the law van Bakker en den Hollander. It's reduce, reuse, recycle, and research. We've learned that actually it is very important that you present the results of your research in a very accessible and simple form, that people can actually work with it and learn from it and improve upon it. So don't make it too complicated. Reduce it to its essence. Reuse. What we've done with the framework, that is new, but all the ingredients in the framework are not new. And there's a wealth of valuable research out there. We know a lot about how to make products last a long time, how to design them so we can repair them. There's a huge amount of work being done, how you can improve the quality and the intensity of the relationship that users have with their products. It's all there. The only thing is it was never used in the context that we placed it in, but it's there. Recycle, with regard to research, there's a lot of research out there that, in essence, touches on good topics and good subjects. The only thing is that the data is too old. So we need to add new data to update what we have to make it more relevant. And the last one is one of the biggest learnings, is that there's so much we don't know yet in order to go truly circular. There's so much data that we need. We need to validate the framework that we've developed. We need to expand it and see if it worked. We have to assemble cases. So my plea here at the end of this presentation is basically document whatever you do and start your experiments now, because everything you do as a company, as a designer, in essence, is research and has the potential to bring us further in getting to a circular economy. So, thank you.
Thank you. Yeah. Thank you, Ruth. Just 1 minute. I want to.
this session is called, we're talking about what's next in terms of research, and you gave us a couple of clues. What would be the project you would like to advance now as, say, this is what I really would like to do, because you've more or less reassembled and recycled many insights and data and put that in a concise form, which is accessible for all people who want to work in terms of circular.
What I found really really inspiring and enlightening was what the students in our circular design cases project have done. Mm-hmm. They have really taken subjects that weren't as evident from the perspective of a circular economy and worked them into circular examples and circular business cases. Mm-hmm. And they've also shown that even when you come from a more linear design education background, you can have the flexibility of mind to take this up and really work with this. So that's one of the things I find really inspiring and challenging, to sort of work with this with students and in design education, to bring this further at the root of where it all starts for industrial design.
Yeah, the statement this morning was it starts with business.
Yeah, it does.
And we have of course the idea of creativity, design, etc. We all know that business and creativity is sometimes a bit not the most easy relationship. Did you encounter conflicts, paradoxes there in your?
No, I'm not sure. I agree fully with that statement, in the sense that I have a background in commercial industrial design, and one of the things I've learned from there is that basically the confinements that you're offered in the brief actually stimulate your creativity, because they force you to sort of work with what you got and come up with really new solutions, because it isn't, you know, unconfined or all open. You have to work with what you got and really be creative to find your solution. So I have good hopes of that.
Okay.
Will work.
Good. Thank you. Okay. Thank you, Marcel. Actually, it was not a deal between us that he would touch upon the students' competition, but it's a very nice bridge to the next part of the program. I want to invite Pieter van Os here, who is going to tell us something about the student competition. And I know there are some people who are very tight and stressful in the audience because we have a result to pronounce or to indicate. So Pieter, the floor is yours.
Thank you. It feels a little bit like the Academy Awards, because we have a winner and I'm going to announce it. But I first will tell you what the winner is all about. We had a contest. And there were more than 300 votes, so probably all of you heard about the contest, because just before summer, and Marcel referred to it, there was an experimental project at the university in Delft for industrial design, and there were 7 brave students who followed a course that was totally new on circular design, and they really made a deep dive into applying the products that last framework. They all chose a product that was close to them, and their challenge was to redesign it in a circular way. And so not only the product, but also the services that accompanying it, and also the business model. And I think, we have a winner now, but it was really a team effort. We have been working on it all together. There were really difficult times in the whole process, and what's first, the business model or the design strategies, how do they relate? And so there was a lot of struggling with the content, and everyone helped each other. So I think that is, every student that joined is a winner in this whole process. But in the end, design and business modeling is also about pitching and presenting it. And so we thought there should also be a contest in which the designers or the students pitch their outcome, and people can vote for that. So in the end, we have one of the 7 students who is the winner of this whole contest. And I will only mention the product that is redesigned, and that's the hockey stick. So Kinge. Can you please come down? And so what you win is this headphone, which is completely circular. But what you also win is 5 minutes of fame to now tell all of us about your circular hockey stick.
All right.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
The floor is yours.
All right. Hello, everybody. My name is Kinge, and I'm a student at the Technical University of Delft. I'm studying strategic product design, and I will tell you about my circular design about the hockey sticks. My focus group was the youth. I didn't expect this PowerPoint to be this big, but maybe you recognize me. The juniors and their hockey sticks, the hockey sticks are used for a really short time, and they are absolutely not recyclable, so that was a big challenge for me. The kids want new sticks because they want new prints, new colors, and secondly because they outgrow their old ones. So I stated my design challenge in how can the technical and usage life of a field hockey stick be brought together in the Netherlands for the youth players. So in other words, for kids when they are hockeying, how can I design a stick that they can and will use for a longer time? I have two solutions for this. The first one is the leasing model. It's about getting access to a hockey stick instead of really owning the stick. There are different gradations, and the more damaged the stick is, the cheaper the model will be. And I made a visualization for this to understand a little bit better. The sticks start at the left side when they are completely new and go into the first gradation. So the kids will use it until it's damaged too much for their league or until they outgrow their old ones. The sticks will continue to the next gradation and the kids will get a new one from their own gradation. This continues until the stick is completely broken and not able to play hockey with it anymore. So then I have a second solution, and that's the sleeve. The sleeve is based on the problem that kids want their new sticks because they want a pretty one, another one, just a new one. So I made a cover for the hockey stick. It's made of a material so you can also play with it. And it's a sacrifice material that's recyclable. So the hockey stick itself will not get damaged anymore and can last a very long time. It's to personalize the stick, but so also to protect the stick. So my business model with that, I made it in the shape of a flower. So first you need to buy the hockey stick. That's the thing that goes up. And then in the middle, the central point is the hockey stick store. They will attach the sleeve and detach it. And I made this the central point of it, so the material will be collected at one point and can be recycled easily. The kids will buy their sleeve, well, I think the parents do, but they will get attached in the hockey store. They will use it for around a season. They will buy a new one in the store or online and will come back to the store to detach the old sleeve and get the new sleeve around their stick. And this is a loop that will continue as long as they want. Then I have a third one, which, I forgot this. You can personalize the stick, for example, with the name of the kids, so they don't lose it, or the club colors. And then, as I said, the third one is combining the two concepts. When you put the sleeve around a hockey stick, when you lease it, you have a one gradation leasing model. The sticks will not get damaged, so they can continue in one loop. And the sleeves will get attached every season, every time a kid leases a new stick. So this kind of solves all the problems about kids wanting a new image for the stick, kids outgrowing their old sticks. These were my solutions. Are there any questions? These are the prototypes that I made. Thank you.
Are there any questions? Short ones, maybe.
Or long ones.
Okay, you. Yeah, tell us your name.
Okay, my name is Herman, MPK. I was wondering whether you had any feedback from the market on your business model or the user.
Well, I was at our stand yesterday at the Dutch Design Week, and I had some kids coming by, and they really liked it. They want the new colors, and I had some parents coming by, and they were saying, I recognize this problem. Those kids always want the new colors and the new patterns. And furtherly, I know there are some people thinking about how, if the material has any influence on how the kid plays with the stick. This, of course, should be tested, but I think it will not make that big of a difference because it's for juniors and it's quite thin material. Mm. But for the rest, I think it's quite positive, all the feedback.
Okay.
Yeah.
There's one point, at a certain point, the stick doesn't fulfill its function anymore and it's out of the circuit. What happens then?
I think that's one problem that I faced in the beginning, that the sticks are really not recyclable.
Uh-huh.
You cannot do it. So I hope in the future they are recyclable, but at least in this design, they are used until they are really broken.
I see.
There's not a solution for it right now.
All right. What was you applied the circle, the products that last framework to develop this? What was the hardest part applying it? Was it the business part?
For me, the hardest part was about the hockey stick itself, because it's just one shape made in such a way that you cannot really do anything with it.
Mm-hmm.
So I had to think about other ways going around that problem. And it's also the competitive field of the hockeyers.
Mm-hmm.
So they want the good material and as best as possible. And so there are a few things that I needed to go around.
Mm. What did you learn?
That it's actually simpler than I thought it would be to design circular. I ended up with quite a simple solution, and it's a small step, but I think you need to have some first small steps.
Yeah, good. Encouraging. Thank you very much. All right. So the next part of the program is that, well, of course, we... Oh, there is the hidden sheets. But some more? Oh, no. Okay, no. This is what we were looking for. You heard a lot about the products at last book. We started off with Marcel, who was one of the authors, and we saw the concepts applied in the real world by one of the students. It makes me curious to learn more about the six other projects, but maybe there's a way to learn about it. They're in the hallway. I missed that, but they've been there all day. Thank you. So the book itself, it has been out there in English, but we have a Dutch version now, and I want to invite Bart Asman, who is working with or in or at least with the project. I'm not very sure. Bart is working on everything, so it's hard to pinpoint him on one point. You have some work to do here. Okay, it's yours.
Yeah, thank you. And well, of course, you've seen an interesting example of what students can do when developing interesting concepts, new examples of what circularity could mean when applied to new products. That's a part of the Circo program. The other part is the workshops that we are doing, the circular business design tracks with companies, with industry partners. And we were very happy that the Ministry of Infrastructure and Environment gave us the opportunity to provide these participants in the workshop with the material that is being used, that is the basis of all the workshops that we do, in the sense that they made it possible to translate and print a Dutch version. Normally, it goes the other way around. You know, you write a Dutch book and you translate it into English. This time, it started off with an English book and has been translated into Dutch to make it more accessible for the Dutch industry. And I'd like to hand over the, let's call it official first version of the book, to Mark Bruin, who is here from the Ministry of Infrastructure and Environment. So, Mark, if you'd like to come over here and then let me see how we do that with two hands and two things in there. But
let's see.
This is the first part, the example. Yeah. And as said, for everybody who's leaving later on, if you give us your badge, you get a copy of the book. I'd like to give you the opportunity to say a few words.
Okay, well, thank you. Thank you for the book. I'm the program manager of the Resource Efficiency Program of the Ministry of Infrastructure and Environment. As part of my job, I was very anxious to learn what Minister President Mark Rutte announced 3 years ago, the coalition program. And in the coalition program, there was one sentence that was actually interesting, which said, this cabinet embraces a circular economy. And of course, that's a very good plan, good for the economy, but also good for the planet. We set up a program for it, considering the advantages we have as a country. And what do we have? We have a good waste management system, we have knowledge, we have good infrastructure, but also we are good in design. And those four things are the main fundament of the program. We're looking at the transition to a circular economy. The biggest step to take is at the front end. That's the design end. That's where you are about. What do you need there? Creativity. And what I see today is free spaces, creativity, but also chaos, connection, all those kind of things you not actually associate a ministry with. So what could we do to stimulate that? Well, to support this kind of movement. So what we do, we support Serco, as you pointed out. Very happy to have this book, but also that I'm sure it will be used and will lead to better design. The parliament is very important for our state secretary, Mansfeld, and to the parliament she promised the Serco program would be multi-year. So that gives her intention. So I'm looking forward for more products from this program and looking forward to more designs that will help us to a circular economy. Well, thank you.
So we keep Bart here as an easy switch to the next part of the program. We're talking here about what's next in terms of research, and of course, when you look forward, there is always a moment to look backward and what has been achieved. Of course, this book, the Serco project, is running. We saw the clip in the beginning that there is a long history in terms of thinking about circular economy. But now we have a moment here where we really do a transfer from a project which finishes right now into a new era. Is a bit big word for it, but anyhow, let's do it that way. Bart is going to introduce, give us an overview of
that's a difficult one.
The EOP IPCR. IPCR.
I'll explain everything.
And then later on we'll inform you about the transfer into Click and L Design and what's going on. So first, you have a couple of remarks about what happened up till now in that program with that name.
Yeah.
No?
Okay. Thank you. You remember this morning it starts with business. It all starts with business. I'd like to take a few steps back and say, okay, where did it all start with? It all started with the IOP IPCR program. IOP stands for Innovative Research Programs. It was a program run by, funded by the Ministry of Economic Affairs and run through what used to be called Agency NL, is now RVO. And IPCR stands for Integrale Product Creatie en Realisatie. And as the chairman always says, and I'm stealing your joke, Joop, we didn't invent the word. Anyhow, it was a program which ran from 2005 until this year. It ends this year. It had a 20.5 million euro budget. A part of that is the co-funding, which has been funded by industry partners. I believe that the subsidy part is about 15 million euros. So an impressive and quite a big research program, focusing completely on research in the design sector. There have been running 17 projects. One of the last ones in the last tender, we're focusing on sustainability. I'll get back to that later on. In total, about 78 partners, just 6 universities. So if you deduct that from these 78 partners, it is clear that there was a lot of industry involved in that. having said that, what were the characteristics of the IOP-IPCR? I was involved since I joined the Delft University 7 years ago. I was involved in the program, and what struck me from the start is the industry involvement. A lot of industrial partners involved, and that was because it was the whole idea behind it is that the research was going to be focusing on or paying a lot of attention to the application of the results in industry. So not purely scientific research, a lot of good research, but through the involvement of industry in a lot of committees and also in the research itself, what you see is that it's not the traditional dissemination approach which you see a lot, which results in articles and presentations at conferences, but also a lot of attention to the real application and involving a lot of companies in there. Another characteristic is that in the fourth then, or so in the last batch of projects, the move was made towards sustainability, and the chairman will explain a bit how it came to that later on. But that has led to a number of inspiring projects like the nature-inspired design project and the Products at Last project, but also a project at Nijmegen University, a project Groningen University, which of which two representatives are here and will join the debate later on. So multidisciplinary, a lot of different researchers involved, a lot of companies involved, and you could say that it at least had a high impact on the research and the design sector. One of which is was the founding of Design United, the organization of the 3TU departments of industrial design. This is 4 years ago. Some people are not working in the sector anymore, have moved abroad. Some you will recognize still, are still working in there. This was the gathering of some people we thought at that time were very important and still are important on design research. And this was the founding of Design United, which has led to a lot of interesting things like the Mind the Step exhibition you can find at the Dutch Design Week here. Another approach, another important item, and you can see all the, you know, what's, you were probably wondering what is this bunch of large books over here. It is sort of to demonstrate that we also placed a focus on making the research results accessible through publications, through books, not only through scientific articles, but also through books that can be read by professionals in the field. And the Advanced Design Methods book was one of these, one of the examples. Another few are standing over there. Not all of them are available as hard copies, but a lot of them are available as PDFs online. So I'd like to invite you to have a look at them. But now that we've the program, the IOP-IPCR program, has come to an end, or will come to an end when once everything is finished, I'd like to invite Jo Postema, chairman of the program. I yesterday heard for 12 years, so somehow my period of 2005 to 2015 probably started earlier. I'd like to invite you to say a few words. Paul will interview you on that, because what we are aiming to do is, of course, to take over the results and the way of working of the IOP-IPCR into ClickNL design. And we'd love to hear from you how to do it, or what the success stories are.
Okay, thank you, Bart. Yeah, great. It's fascinating to see that actually there is a kind of smooth development from more, it seems to me, more industrial-based kind of questions into more designerly issues, sustainability, these kind of questions. You've been aboard, you say, for 12 years in this project. What was the evolution you've seen because the fourth tender was about sustainability. But there is probably a kind of short history on how the questions and the issues evolved in the period. Could
how much time do I have?
Yeah, well, at least 3 minutes.
I took over in 2004. The actual project started in 1997, mm-hmm. after a research by Berenschot. The proposal was first presented. It took then 7 years, and in that period, IPCR meant, in fact, how can we tool faster, how can we use CAD systems faster, how can we accelerate the whole introduction of products. So very much hardware-oriented. Mm-hmm. The first tender was in 2005, and the first project started in 2006. Still focusing on product development in the classical, at that time, the classical way. We have seen in that period, time didn't stand still. We saw more focus on user involvement. We saw more focus on the production chain. Mm-hmm. Things were not anymore vertical integrated. And in around 2008 it must have been, again Berenschot, stimulated by the FME, did a series of studies, workshops, looking at what does the future hold. And in that period, in the streets, people heard about climate change, CO2 emissions. During those studies of Berenschot, it became more, was more common awareness. Well, it is more than that. There is also a threatening shortage of materials. Mm. So the picture became more and more complex. And we decided to change the focus, and it has to be on sustainability. That involved more parties than the traditional three TUs, as you have seen earlier today. It also involved different companies. And we have seen a mixture of projects in the last tender focusing on what does it mean for business models. Mm. How do you make clear that sustainability is more than just reducing the energy consumption? It is more than just recycling the waste at the end. Mm. But I can continue.
One last small question, again a small question. You've worked in a complex situation, of course, with government funding, with subsidies, with companies, with universities, etc. So that must have been quite complex to manage such a project. What is your main recommendation for the future in terms of circular economy, getting research done, getting it implemented, getting companies involved, etc.? What would be your two main recommendations to the people who take over here?
Continuous click and L. I would like to get back about 5 years ago. We ran a project, user-centered design, mm-hmm. which at that moment was quite enlightening. A lot of companies were involved. Jasper van Kuik presented it on television. And then the danger is that you think, okay, things are done, things are well known. Yesterday afternoon, I attended a workshop where the presenter asked the audience the question, how many companies involve the end customer in design, in the design and concept of a new product? Nobody guessed right. Mm. The answer was less than 20%. Mm. So that illustrated for me, it made clear how big the gap often is between the people involved, mm-hmm. Who tend to think about, okay, what is next, mm-hmm. and tend to forget, mm-hmm. what certainly is in the scope of economic affairs, mm-hmm. how can we spread it mm-hmm. to a much wider group of companies?
Yeah.
How can we involve FME? And the workshops today and yesterday, to me, illustrated excellent examples of spreading to a much wider audience what the people involved knew. Yeah, I know that we did last year or 2 years ago. At least that's my personal observation often.
Yeah. Okay.
So certainly continue, if possible, spread it, made it wider. But definitely it looks like an excellent concept of spreading the results to a much wider public.
Okay. Thank you very much. Joop Postma, ladies and gentlemen. We have now a moment where Daan van Eyck joins us, if I'm right. Yes, I'm right. And he's going to tell you a bit about how the concept and the notion and the theme of circular economy will be taken up by Click & L design in the coming years. Am I right?
Yeah.
All right. There you go.
Thank you. And have the next slide. Joop was already, of course, talking about the user. And the work with the user, I think, will be never ending, because it's different ways, co-creation, involvement in all different ways. But we also think when we look at the research domain, specifically in this area of circular economy, we've been working on it, it's one of the main focal points for Click & L design for the coming years. We're very happy to have Circo on board, or as a project, because that's, of course, mainly about spreading the things. But we also learn from that and we get it back. So I've been looking also in the industry, because these are our partners, but also in the scientific world, what could be areas to work on? And of course we have to focus, and they're still broad, but of course we like to discuss that with all of you. Customer behavior, of course when we go from pay to own to pay per use, and when you look at a few of the scenarios, that will give a very different customer behavior. And why should a customer choose for pay, let's say, for pay per use or pay per own? Why should he stay there? What are the, let's say, elements to make this choice? And what is the relationship between them? So that's an interesting field of study, not only interesting, but also, I think, necessary to make a next step there. That's one. On the other hand, of course, when we talk about, we just saw the example of the hockey stick, you have one lifetime that's kind of over in this circular economy. You got a second one, a third one, a fourth one, even more. And how do people perceive that? Of course, there's a financial thing there, but it's also, are you still attached to them? Do you like to use things would be used by another one? How you can upgrade them? So there's a lot of aspects on these different lifespans. The second area is the integrated design approach. Cool. We see and we hear, and because we started with business today, design thinking is entering the boardrooms. I think of the big companies, but also means we as a design community, but not only the design community, let's say the total community, have to integrate these aspects. So you talk about circular products and services, but also circular business models and how you integrate, how are the relationships between these three? What is more important? Or less important, how is that related to the context it's used in? So it's expanding the world, expanding our knowledge, but also how we do this. What is the design process? What's the effect on design processes? So that's, a second area. And of course, there we also have to look at how is that related to design education? Because what we look now, when we look at the design education in the Netherlands, but also abroad, it's very much product focus, we're just adding services, maybe a little business models, but of course people we educate now, they have to do the work for the coming generation. So we have to see how we deal with that and whether we have to add things or change things there. Now the last part, of course, is turning the change into circles that we can talk about is now linear, it has to be circular. Of course, you first have to understand what it is, but how you do that? What is the, let's say, the governance mechanism? How could that be done? How can you help suppliers with very practical steps? How, and it's not only one supplier, because a supplier has a customer, and that customer is in fact sometimes also a supplier, so it's a whole chain. So they all have to move. So how could you support it? Maybe you need a new type of infrastructural services to do so, maybe software or other ways to do so. So it's, I think, interesting to come from where we are now and make that step. So we need that vision. We need people who see that, who believe in that, that it will work. Of course, it will not be easy, but a lot of things changing is not, a lot of times changing is not easy. But I think we also need more research. So it's not only about the knowledge we have now, and I fully see that. I mean, there's a long history, even, of course, before IOP, IPCR, this project. I mean, for tens of years, people have been studying this type of topics. But it's one we have to bring that over, to bring it into practice. On the other hand, I think we have to continue asking these questions and see how we can bring that into new research. So that's what I want to say.
Okay. Thank you. Dan, I have one or two small questions. This is a kind of preliminary kind of agenda. Is this something you're going to work on? Is this becoming an official kind of document where you state this is what we're going to do, and NWO and RVO are taking it up? Is that?
No, taking it up, of course. Hopefully. These are the things we bring forward, and I just raised some questions. Of course, there are more questions. We have to see how to bring that into programs, get it fine, and that's, of course, a main task for ClickNL, to get it on the agenda, to get budget for it, but also to bring parties together, as of course is an idea of today, but also other days, and really bring it into concrete new projects. Yeah. Because IOP was a great program, but of course now it's all over to the top sectors, and we're part of that, and so there's a possibility to do so.
Okay.
So we will do.
Yeah, thank you. Take a seat over there if you like. I would like to call to the... Oh, of course. I would like to call to the floor Hans Wortmann. He's professor of information management at the University of Groningen. So take a seat also, as well as Christina Lauge from Radboud University, professor in organizational development and design, and Marcel den Hollander, if you would like to take a seat over there. As I understood from the earlier presentations, you both did projects in the EOP program, so you're completely connected, I would say. In the meantime, we did some work on what happened in the workshops, and of course it's impossible to summarize what's been happening, even if you consider that I saw a lot of workshops going on with post-its and all these kind of things, so there's really work done, but we made a small summary in three kind of statements, and I would like to just simply position that for you and ask you for some comments. The one is, and it came back in Dan's list also, the user perspective is vital. So I think what design has brought to the fore in all these programs is that you should involve the user, look at the user, etc. But at the same time, it was astonishing that you said that only 20% of the companies still really consult users if they're developing products and services. So the user is very essential. The other part, the other conclusion was that design agencies should be more proactive when developing new concepts and business models for circular economy. So there's work to do over there. That was the second conclusion. And the third one is that there is still an issue, who is taking the lead in organizing the network or the supply chain, because we have all different actors working in that network or chain or how you call it, or circle, how you call it, but who is actually responsible for the general picture, for the coordination of all this? Is that the designer? Is that the industrial company? Is that maybe some work for the government, or is it ClickNL, or is it a branch, or whatever? So these are three topics which have been coming up to today, and of course these are not all the topics, but I simply would like to ask Christina first to react on this, and if you have other strong statements to make about what you saw today, please don't hesitate to do that.
Okay. I think one of the things that runs through these three insights is designers as change agents. So designers can bring something that can help to further facilitate the change towards a circular economy. And I think that is a very valuable point, so that would connect to the first one, to bringing in the user perspective, taking a more proactive role. I don't think there is a definitive answer in whose responsibility it is. Based on our research, I would say that it depends on who is most passionate about it and starts taking the initiative, and that can be pretty much anyone. So it can be middle managers who try to convince their senior management and start off initiatives. It can be a design agency. It can be somebody who's brought in as an external facilitator in a very complex network of public and private parties. For me, what an important insight is that this is a change process, and we should actually look at it as a change process. And it's changing user behavior. That is one of the things that was also on Dan's list. So the consumer behavior aspect, that's one of the behavioral changes. But it's also a change in organizations, and possibly also a change in on policy level. And I think it would be valuable for the future steps to connect to people who have expertise on how do you change customer behavior? How do you change organizations? How do you change policy? So that we are not putting all the responsibility on the poor designer who hopefully will make the miracle happening. We had a nice workshop on designer as change agency, and we had a superwoman. And I think designers can be great heroes and they can make great differences, but we shouldn't overemphasize what that poor person is going to do. We should link it up to people who have studied changes in other disciplines. And in that sense, I think the last round of IPCR was a step into what I would see as the right direction to connect to other disciplines. So for me, the reason to leave Delft, where I had a great time and learned a lot, was the opportunity to move into a business school, because I think I can do more to change the world if from a business school, with my background and my expertise. And I think that this kind of collaborations across boundaries can help us to make those changes.
Yeah, Kenna, just one question. What occurs to me, the concept when you talk about this, is the concept of leadership. Is that somewhere in your model or in your way of thinking?
I'm very skeptical about leadership because I, again, don't believe in heroes. So for me, the change is a lot more sort of an Olieflek concept, a lot more a question of how do you change practices? And you don't change practices by having a great leader tell people that they should change. It is a lot more about getting credibility on the ground, gaining legitimacy, institutionalizing things, mainstreaming them. So it requires passionate, inspired people, but the leader, if there are no followers, the leader will do nothing.
I see. Yeah, okay. You see. Yeah. This is a great insight for me. Thank you, Dan. Yes. Okay, what's your general observation? Thank you very much, because it was very, very helpful. Yeah.
Well, a couple of remarks. First of all, you said one of the findings was re-establishing user involvement. And I think that is true, but it can become even more true if we would find a way to take the people more into consideration, out of people, planet, profit. So designers, of course, see people mainly as users, but you can also see people, for example, as employees in manufacturing systems or elsewhere in our labor system, or people not necessarily as users, but as those who are being affected in one way or another. So I would say yes, please use a focus, but also don't forget the people in the system. Secondly, Mark, you said the designer should be more proactive. I agree, but I also think it is remarkable that in design we still typically think and educate the design of physical products. I've never seen a CAD system for services. But I have also not seen an educational system for services. So we say that we are moving towards product service systems, but what we mean with the services, how we design them. So I think there is a lot to do in future branches of design, so to say, including, of course, what you mentioned about user experiences and user perceptions. And the third remark that you made, who has to take the lead? I do not think designers can take the lead. I think designers are visionary people, creative people. They can show us possible futures, but they are not going to change the world. Sometimes, of course, in their vision, but that's not through power, but through influence, through example through stories and not by financial means. I think the change towards a circular economy will, on the one hand, come from business strategies, and business strategies should indeed be aligned with the circular economy. But you can also take a lesson from other fields that have managed to change behavior in the recent past. I give you one example. In Western Europe and in America, maybe in all mature countries, I've seen over the last decades very much an increase in attention for workers' health. Health, safety, and environmental issues are very important now in companies' behavior that were not at all important 30 years ago. That is apparently something which culturally has come over the stage. So it can happen. And then you see that let's say, main contractors and subcontractors, etc., establish those programs and make them happen. So I think in the same thinking, the larger companies should, for instance, start to see the waste processors as suppliers. Means purchasing people should be trained not only to purchase classical materials, but purchase from waste processors. That's not happening now. That's not the and therefore, if you want to get this broadly accepted, the government, but also the general public, should make a lot of steps in many disciplines, not just in design.
And in terms of your concept, do you agree with Christina on bottom-up kind of processes where actually step-by-step you try to...
I tend to think that the big leap forward is not existing. Many people starting with small initiatives can create a great movement.
Okay, thank you.
Sure.
Marcel, you have a phone. Yeah. Well, could you, for a short, because you had some airtime already, a short reaction on, because we'd like to have the audience also included, on previous speaker and the themes, yeah?
I'll try to take you three subjects at once. I think what is important in this case is on the one hand value, and on the other hand time. And I think designers won't be the all-important people in that they can drive change because they operate within a business context. But if users and a wider society starts to value other things because there's a lack of them or they become scarce, and governments will provide a framework that creates an atmosphere where change and changing towards more sustainable or towards a more circular way of doing business is favored, then I think you'll get change. And for businesses, you can only be successful if you actually provide something that is valuable to the user, and you can only create stuff that's valuable to the user if you understand what they value and what their values are. So I think they're interlinked, and you can't look at one of them separately.
Yeah. All right. I would like to see if there are any practitioners in the design profession or designers in the audience, because you've not been here on stage up till now, who would like to comment on what is said now. Are there any design professionals in the room who would feel like I would like to make a comment on this? Mostly in the beginning, nobody wants, but in the end, there are three or four who want to speak, but then time is over. So better put up your hand now. Yes, I see. Yeah, okay. You throw, okay. All right, good. Yeah, it works.
So you're talking about process of bottom up and top down. And I'm sort of directing this question to Christina or all of you, but isn't it really about a flat organization in the future, or are we working toward a flat organization? How does that affect all these concepts we're talking about?
Yeah, you want to comment on that?
Oh, sorry.
I think it almost implies flat, doesn't it?
Okay. I didn't mean my comment as it's only bottom up. We are partly moving to flatter organizations, but I don't see hierarchies disappearing quickly. I'm tempted to say not in my lifetime. I think what we're seeing is more networks between organizations. So I think we're moving from hierarchical relations between organizations to more networks between organizations. I don't think hierarchies within organizations will disappear quickly. And my vote against leadership was not meant it's all bottom up. It's a process that starts from multiple places in organizations and between organizations. It can have the character of a social movement, but it can also be passionate senior managers. But from what we've seen, usually those senior managers have been informed by other people who've tried to put the issue to them, or they've grown up with a passion that they then put on the plate once they have the power to influence structures. I don't think it will be, we will be working in complete flat organizations in the near future.
Okay, more questions from others than designers only. Nobody?
Just try.
You can throw and we'll see who catches it. And they simply, yeah, up. Oh. Nobody. So if you're all, okay, yeah, there you go.
Okay.
Tell us who you are.
I'm Jos de Lange, working at the University of Twente, also part of the IOP project.
All right.
And I've saw a lot of inspiring examples. We're at a change agent and we saw the headphones in circular economy based on modular design. Perfect example. But my concern is that we deviate from the original problem, which is the planet. And how are we going to measure our strategies? How are we going to measure our efforts into a circular economy? And how are we going to be stay sharp at our design strategies and keep moving that forward? I'm a bit concerned that's a bit oversight.
What would you like to measure? What would you like to measure?
Our efforts into becoming a circular economy, are we doing its best?
Uh-huh.
And measured it against, I guess, the planet?
I do not fully grasp your question, but maybe you do, because you're also an IOP project, you must know.
If I may give a reaction, I think indeed that, let's say, in many respects, the ways in which companies report their environmental efforts is rather subjective, and leaves a lot of room for these companies to, let's say, position themselves in the light which is most beneficial for themselves. And if you compare that, for instance, to what we have seen with the accounting measures over the recent decades, you see that there is a lot of legislation, but also, let's say, behavioral norms in how to report on what you're actually doing. In corporate social responsibility, we also see also emerging norms between companies on the terminology to be used, the issues to be addressed, the measures to be taken, etc. And in sustainability, that is still in its infancy. For example, in if you use the LCA measures, then of course a couple of procedures are well established, but in many cases there are, let's say, the numbers used are numbers which are industry averages, and that means that if you, as a particular industry, do an improved job, that is not reflected in any of your customers' numbers due to the fact that they take, again, these industry averages rather than the specific supplier who does a better job. So I agree with you that an effort to standardize and improve our measurements, hopefully without a lot of bureaucracy and legal issues that we have with the accountants. Nevertheless, that would be from a legislation point of view, would be something that is needed in the future to really get let's say numbers on which consumers and others can rely.
Yeah. If I may add to that, short, and then we go to Christina.
If I may add to that, there's work being done in the UK by the Ellen MacArthur Foundation and Granda and a few others to actually create a circularity index. And to make it possible to sort of determine in numbers, basically, how circular your company is working.
Yeah.
So there is work being done, so don't despair. But another thing was that was the reason for my appeal, start documenting what you do, because it's so new that we need all the research and data we can get in order to determine whether we're going the wrong way or not.
Yeah, maybe. I would like to ask you one question, and maybe you could address that in your answer. Do you think regulations are effective in terms of achieving more circular economy-like situations, or would you see it more as a promotional or PR instruments for companies that they can show what they do in terms of sustainability or circular indexes, etc.?
Both applies. We need all the means that we can get. So regulation can help, and there's evidence that it has helped in industry. So. It brings issues to the forefront and then forces organizations to do something with it. But we also see that the industry is sometimes ahead of regulation, and where they are being proactive, they're actually using it as a reputational risk management issue and as a way to position themselves. I had one thing on your question. The financial industry is actually providing measures in the sense that they provide reviews of companies for investors that care about company reputation. So there is ecological, social, and governmental responsibility, and from that perspective, they review what companies do. And I would disagree with you that the planet was the main purpose. This might be a bit cynical, but I think we've already ruined so much of the planet that it's much more important to think about fair distribution of resources and of the problems that we create. So to me, it's just as important that we address this as a social question and not just as a planet question, because the planet is not in isolation of the people that live on it. So I think if we make it an environmental problem only, then we're missing part of the reason why we were doing circular economy in the first place.
Yeah. Okay.
I think the planet determines our limitations and our requirements, and not the social aspect and not the profit aspect.
I take this as an indication that the debate continues. And I would like to stop it for the plenary session over here, because we're already over time. And it's, of course, a nice bridge to at least the promise that there will be a next ClickNL Design Drive in 2016, and it's in the third week of October during the Design Week. The specific format is still to be established, but we'll expect you back here next year. Isn't it, Dan?
It is.
Yeah, great. So thank you very much, everybody, the audience, the organizers, the panelists, for the past 2 days. It's been great, and we hope to see you back next year. Thank you very much.